In this video, we're solving an unusually challenging conservation of energy problem that I put on a recent problem set for one of my physics courses. Now, at first glance, it looks like a pretty innocent energy conservation problem. We have a rough incline, so we have to deal with friction here. And there's a mass on this incline, and we've compressed it against a spring with a given constant. And of course, we're given the initial compression distance and the angle of incline here. So at first glance, we're thinking, okay, no big deal. We're just going to write down E initial plus the work done by friction is equal to E final, and we'll be able to solve for whatever this guy is asking. But the question I'm asking here is a little bit unusual. Instead of asking for the maximum height this thing slides up the ramp, I'm asking for the maximum speed of the block. And most people's guess would be that that maximum speed occurs at the equilibrium location for the spring, and that's actually wrong. So by the time the mass gets back to the equilibrium position for the spring force has been smaller than the combination of the parallel component of gravity and the friction. Those both point down the ramp. So when that spring force drops below the combination of our parallel component of gravity and our friction force, this object is actually going to be slowing down. That means the maximum speed must have occurred sometime before that. So what we really need to focus on here is the transition between speeding up and slowing down. And this occurs when the spring force pointing up the ramp has just dropped low enough to equal the sum of the other two forces down the ramp. Now the force diagram gets pretty complicated for this problem. So we're actually going to make a new diagram where we can just see everything a little more cleanly. So this gives us a little more space to work. And the position we're looking at here is the special position where we hit the maximum speed. Again, the key physical point about that is that the spring force up the ramp is going to balance the two forces that pull down the ramp, because this is the cut line between speeding up and slowing down. So we need a complete force diagram here, and as usual, we start with the force of gravity. And as usual, we see that angle between the vertical and the perpendicular is the same as the angle of incline for the ramp. So now we can decompose that force of gravity into the usual parallel and perpendicular components. And that perpendicular component is mg cosine theta because it corresponds to the adjacent side. And then our parallel component points down the ramp, and that's mg sine theta, which corresponds to the length of the opposite side of this right triangle. But we show it attached to the mass itself because it's more intuitive that way. Next, we'll get the normal force into the diagram. We need that because we have to compute a friction force. And there's nothing else going on in the perpendicular direction, so the normal force simply balances the perpendicular component of gravity. Now, of course, the normal force mediates the friction force, so now we can compute a friction force, and we're just going to call that Fk for now. And then I have a third force in the parallel direction. That's the spring pushing up the ramp. So again, right now, the spring is transitioning from exerting a larger force than Fk plus mg sine theta, and it's about to start losing the battle and the mass will start slowing down. So this has to be our moment of maximum speed. So what we're trying to get out of the calculation we're about to do is x. That's going to be the compression distance of the spring at this special moment where we hit the maximum velocity. So at this special location, we know that the spring force, I'll call that F sub SP, just to make it a little shorter, is equal to the kinetic friction force plus mg sine theta. So the spring force at this point is just given by Hooke's law, so that's kx. And then our friction force, that's mu k times the normal force. So I'll write that as mu k mg cosine theta. And then we have our second force pulling down the ramp, that's mg sine theta, the parallel component of gravity. So it's pretty quick to find an expression for the x value here. And as I do this, I'm going to factor an mg out of these two terms on the right-hand side. So I end up with an mg divided by k multiplied by mu k cosine theta plus sine theta. And now we can go ahead and plug our numbers into this. Remember the mass was 500 grams, so we're going to write that as half a kilogram. G is about 9.8. The spring constant was 40 newtons per meter. Our kinetic friction coefficient was 0.24, and our angle is 30 degrees. And when we run the numbers on this to three significant digits, we get a compression distance of about 0.0867 meters. You could also write that as 8.67 centimeters, but we have to use it later in our calculations, so might as well leave it in SI units. Okay, now we know where the mass is when it's moving at its largest speed, but we still have to compute that speed. That's where we get into a conservation of energy problem. So I'm going to go back to my original diagram, and then at the very end, we'll be able to plug in this x value. So I've made a couple modifications to the original diagram. Note that I've allowed the spring to expand a little bit, and we get to this position x where I know that the speed is a maximum. So that label x is now added to the diagram. That original compression distance is 50 centimeters, but we're going to work with that symbolically as an x naught in all of our calculations. And then the goal, of course, is to find the speed at this special location, and that's going to be our maximum speed. So now we apply conservation of energy, and we have a non-conservative force here, that's the friction. So I have E initial plus the work done by any non-conservative forces is equal to E final. And our initial state is where the spring was fully compressed to 50 centimeters. The final state is where the spring is partially decompressed, and I've reached my maximum speed. So in our initial state, the only source of energy we have is the spring potential energy at that initial compression distance. Note that when I say that, I've automatically chosen this initial location as y equals zero for the purpose of measuring gravitational potential energy. In other words, the origin is at the initial location of the object. Now we have some work done by friction here, so we get into this non-conservative term. That's the work done by the friction force, and that comes with a minus sign because the friction force points opposite the direction of motion here. So we have that friction force acting through a distance as the block slides up to the point of interest. And we can see in the diagram, with an initial compression of x naught, and then this final position of x below the equilibrium position, the sliding distance must be x naught minus x. Now in our final state, we have several things going on. We still have some spring potential energy because the spring is not completely back to its equilibrium position yet. So we have a 1/2 kx squared for the spring potential energy. Of course, we also have some kinetic energy, and that's the term we're really interested in because we're trying to get to that Vmax. So we have a 1/2 mVmax squared. Finally, we also have some gravitational potential energy because the block is higher than it used to be. Again, the total sliding distance has been x naught minus x, but we only want the vertical component of that. So that's going to be an x naught minus x times the sine of the angle of incline. So gravitational potential energy in our final state is mgy, so mg times our new y coordinate, which again is going to be an x naught minus x, that's the hypotenuse here, times the sine of theta, and that gives us just the final vertical coordinate. So we really want to solve for V max here. So I'm just going to isolate that and write it on the left-hand side and then collect all my terms to the other side of the equation. So the first thing I think about is subtracting this 1/2 kx squared from both sides, but there's some nice factoring we can do over there on the other side. We can factor out a 1/2 k, and then we're left with an x naught squared minus x squared. Our friction term is also on the other side of the equation, but I'll put in the details of the friction now. The friction force is given by mu k times the normal force, which was mg cosine theta. And then, of course, we still have to multiply by that displacement, x naught minus x. Finally, we subtract our gravitational potential energy term over to the other side. So we'll just keep it like that for now, minus mg times the quantity x naught minus x times sine theta. So I'm going to do a couple things in the next step. I'm going to multiply both sides of the equation by 2, and that'll get rid of these 1/2s, and it'll put a 2 into the rest of the terms. At the same time, I'm going to factor out a negative mg times x naught minus x from these last two terms. They have all those terms in common. So now we have mvmax squared is equal to k times x naught squared minus x squared minus 2, because remember I multiplied everything by 2, so minus a 2 mg times x naught minus x, just factoring that out of both terms. And this leaves me with a mu k cosine theta plus sine theta. So finally, we're going to divide by m and then square root the result to isolate Vmax. So when I divide by m, that first term is going to be a k over m times x naught squared minus x squared. And then in our second term, the m's are going to cancel out. So I get a minus 2g x naught minus x mu k cosine theta plus sine theta. And remember, we have to square root this whole thing. So we're ready to plug numbers into this giant square root. And you can tell I'm preparing for something pretty dramatic here. That's a long square root. So we sub in our k, that was 40. We sub in our m in SI units, that's 0.5. Then I have my x naught squared, so 0.5 squared minus x squared. So x was that special position where we get the maximum speed. So I get a 0.0867 all squared there. Then we have minus 2 times g, so 2 times 9.8, times x naught minus x. That's 0.5 minus 0.0867. And of course, my square root wasn't long enough. And we sub in our friction coefficient, 0.24. Cosine of the angle, that's cosine 30 degrees, plus sine 30 degrees. And when we run the numbers on this to three significant digits, we get about 3.70 meters per second. So if we had taken the naive approach to this problem, and we accidentally just looked at the location where the spring reached its equilibrium length, we would have come out with a speed that was somewhat less than this, because after that position x, the mass is slowing down. If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.